Okay. So, sir, what's your reaction to the verdict on Babri Masjid and Ram Janmabhoomi title suit?
I conveyed my reaction on the same day, and the following day I had issued a statement, which apparently has been published by your organization. The basic point is that in my view, the judgment goes beyond the mandate given to it by the Supreme Court. The Allahabad verdict is in a sense extra-legal.
Okay.
Because it goes into a question which the Supreme Court itself had refused to answer.
Okay.
The Supreme Court did not ask them to partition the property.
Okay.
The Supreme Court asked them to find the title to the property.
Okay.
And we feel that the Allahabad High Court or any of the judges have not come out with any evidence to show that the entire area of the Babri Masjid and beyond is Ram Janmabhoomi, or that Ram was born exactly on the point, if at all he was ever born, where the Masjid's pulpit now stands. You see, because it was not even a miraculous action. Human hands had first put it in the inner courtyard and then transplanted the idol on the mihrab, under the mihrab, on the top of the minbar. So, in any case, my basic reaction is that the Muslims feel that by going beyond the law, beyond the direction of the Supreme Court, beyond what they were supposed to do, it is basically an expression of a majoritarian view, which is based on religion, which is based on that the majority religion must prevail.
Okay.
And to that extent, we find it unacceptable and we reject it.
Okay. What do you think? There is a view that the implication of this verdict goes beyond Ayodhya, you know, goes beyond, you know, and it can be very disastrous for a secular country like India.
I think I've got a point there, because actually the judgment has been very severely criticized, much more severely than even the Muslim leaders or the Muslim organizations.
Okay.
By the secular minded individuals, by the non-Muslim intelligentsia, by senior advocates, and by many academicians. For example, I give you one thing. One retired Chief Justice of the High Court and a senior advocate of the Supreme Court has said that it is like a panchayat which is dividing a property. It has turned into a partition suit. It has not remained a title suit. Somebody has said that, today I read an article which said by a former Deputy Attorney General of India that it is a majoritarian judgment. And therefore, this pleases me. This gives me satisfaction that in our country, the spirit of secularism is not dead. That everybody is not going to fall in line with the majoritarian view of judiciary. And I may add there that the Muslims have always been unhappy with the majoritarian attitude prevailing in the executive. But they have always gone to the judiciary thinking that judiciary is above these communal feelings. But Allahabad High Court has completely shattered that myth.
Okay.
Therefore, it has indeed a very wide-ranging implication, both in time and in the, shall we say, the reputation of India beyond its borders. How secular is this country?
There is a view that, you know, this case was a litmus test for a secular model, for a secular country of India. Like, some people feel that it was a litmus test in the sense that you know, this case would have decided, if minorities in India have to live, They have to live as per their own wishes or as per the majoritarian views. I mean, if they have to live safely, they have to earn, within quotes, goodwill of the majority community, you know. So
I would only like to add one thing to you. The majority community does not have a common, sect religion. In history, there have been great fights and battles between those who believed in Shiva and those who believed in Vishnu.
Vaishnavites.
There have been great fights between Buddhists and Hindus. And today even, there are many sects in India which you know, try to occupy the Hindu mind. And therefore, if this view prevails, that the majority shall dictate its terms on the title to a place in dispute, then not only no church, no masjid, no gurdwara is safe. But even among the Hindus, many temples which belong to a smaller sects will have to bear the brunt.
You know, there is a view like that, okay, you know, this judgment actually, you know, Muslims were, judiciary was the only pillar that Muslims used to have hope from, you know. So this makes them a bit more skeptical towards judiciary.
I agree with you, but after all, 3 judges don't make the Indian judiciary.
Yeah, exactly.
And there are about 600 or 700 High Court judges, and I cannot say that all of them, in their heart of hearts, can believe or accept this sort of judgment. And in any case, the Supreme Court is yet to apply its test. How far they can accept this, that a High Court which was asked by mandate only to determine the title to the disputed site, to whom does it belong? And the Supreme Court had itself laid down how the problem is to be resolved after the title is decided. They said if the title is decided in favor of Hindus, a temple will be built. But nearby a masjid will be built. And if the title is decided in favor of the Muslims, the masjid will be built. And nearby a temple will be built. That would have been a test of secularism. But to give away something on the basis of mythology, on the basis of what they call my faith, I believe this, it's totally wrong. There is no evidence of any of these elements in the judgment. Where Ram was born, whether Ram was born exactly at that spot. And I have always been telling my friends that according to my way of thinking, and we respect Ram so much as an icon of Indian culture, that the entire India is his Janma Bhoomi. Entire Ajodhya is his Janma Bhoomi. How can he be restricted to a particular spot inside the Babri Masjid? So therefore, I have not lost hope, but you are absolutely right that the pillar of our faith has really been
shaken. Okay. So what's the road ahead? Like, what's the road ahead? Do you expect some strong comments from Supreme Court on this behavior by High Court?
Well, I don't know what the Supreme Court will do.
Mm-hmm.
But all I can say is that the Muslim community will definitely approach the Supreme Court to clear these mushrooms, to clear these cobwebs that have been put over the Babri Masjid. What the Supreme Court will decide, I don't know. I can only say we shall try to argue our case to the best of our ability. And I'm sure in this we shall be morally supported and encouraged by all the secular forces of India, all the progressive forces of India, because they all think that this judgment does not bring honor to the country, it brings infamy to the country. But what will happen finally, I don't know. But I would add one thing more, to be fair. We have always been saying that whatever be the final judicial verdict, the Muslim community will accept. There can be no higher court than the Supreme Court. So even if I do not like the Supreme Court judgment, I have to accept it. If I am a good citizen and if I believe in the Constitution of India, there is no higher court to go. Therefore, I will have to accept the Supreme Court judgment. And that is one thing that I want to tell you, that there is no sort of question of Muslims trying to violate the constitution or going outside the framework of the constitution. We believe in the rule of law and we believe in the constitution.
Okay, so you think that Supreme Court, going to Supreme Court, is a way ahead for the Muslims. But okay, let's talk a bit in the larger picture. There is a view in among the Muslim social activists that why did, this whole issue has been started, particularly the politics of this whole issue has been started by Hindutva groups. Why, what was the need to bring the whole, this issue as Hindu versus Muslims?
Nobody did it that way. I don't think you have read the history right. The point was that it was a Muslim masjid which was entered, in which illegally and surreptitiously at the dead of night, according to the district magistrate of that town, idols had been placed there. And they were claimed to have appeared miraculously. And as you know, many sadhus fought among themselves for the honor as to
who put the idols,
planted the idol. And one thing more that you must keep in mind, Ayodhya for the last 200 years or 300 years has been associated with the name of Ram. But not before that. There is no Ram temple in the whole of India before the 16th century. And surely Babur could not have demolished all the Ram temples in the country. And mind you, none of these three judges have said exactly that a mandir was in fact demolished before the masjid was built there. And what is universally legal, which will appeal to all people all over the world, there is a universal doctrine of what they call adverse possession. Assuming that a mandir is stood, and assuming that Babur or his commander demolished it to build the masjid thereon, which was an un-Islamic act, according to that, it will not be a proper masjid at all. But in law, when such a situation arises, 500 years of existence, aren't they enough for claiming adverse possession? While here, the adverse possession is being claimed because an idol was introduced by human hands inside Babri Masjid in the last less than 60 years. So it's a peculiar situation which does not make sense. It is, as I said, not only an extra legal judgment, it is an unreasonable judgment. And it, as I told you earlier, it goes against the work that was given to the Allahabad High Court.
Okay.